BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
New Arts Alive features the guest artists who will share their work for a better understanding of today's art. Program moderator is James Carroll. During the live presentation, the home viewer has the opportunity to call and speak directly with the artist. New Arts Alive is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit arts service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. New Arts Alive is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, area businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions.
Good afternoon, and welcome again to the latest edition of New Arts Alive here on BCTV. I'm your host for tonight, I'm Ron Schira, and I will be interviewing tonight a special guest. This is Peter Rampson, and Peter is the curator, the teacher, professor at Alvernia University. He's in charge literally of the Miller Gallery over there at Alvernia, and he's got classes. What did I miss? Did I miss something?
I don't think so. I you know, again, just gallery curator and work on programming for the gallery, and as an assistant professor at the university, I teach a variety of graphic arts courses.
There. Graphic arts courses, yep.
And then just artist and graphic, you know, design, you know, enthusiast as well, too.
You wear a lot of hats, really. You're a very diversified person and totally in tune with the educational system, I must say.
Thank you.
You do a lot for that organization, that college, rather.
Thank you.
So, we're here to talk about a couple of things. We talk about the gallery. Mm-hmm. We're also here to talk about your artwork, you know, especially your artwork, because I think that, you know, since you're relatively new to the area, that people really don't really have a really good idea of what you do. Mm-hmm. Now, you've had some of your work shown at Studio B and, you know, and at a couple of, like, group activities around here, mm-hmm. but you're a newcomer to the area, so we don't really have that much history on you. You want to tell us about some of your background?
Background. I guess a quick background would be born and raised in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. I'm an only child. I was fortunate enough to attend the Rhode Island School of Design for my undergraduate and then North Carolina State University for my graduate work. And after that, I started teaching and have been teaching now for about 12 years.
Wow. Wow. So, aiming for the long run.
For the long run. I really have a great passion for teaching. I enjoy teaching. I find myself to be at home a lot in the classroom. It's really where I most desire to be. The students keep me young, Ron.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Yeah, you're surrounded by youth. You can't help but rub off, you know. I mean, I really admire and respect the youth of today because I really think that they really got it on the ball much more than my generation did, which was a bunch of... You know, but yeah. So anyway, yeah. Congrats, kids. You're doing good. Let's talk a little bit about the gallery.
The gallery at Alvernia University. We were lucky enough to have it donated by Ginger and Marlon Miller, and they are again wonderful supporters of the arts. Mm-hmm. I've only been here now for 4 years at the university. Just finishing up, and so I'm really starting to learn about their involvement in the arts here, even in Berks County as well, too. The gallery itself has only been open for 4 years. It seemed like it was built for me, but it was not. It's built, again, to start to bring some really interesting programming to the university to start to bring a better understanding and awareness of art. We try to bring as many creative and different sort of programs to the gallery to inspire thinking across curriculum and across multiple disciplines as well,
multiple
too.
Multiple disciplines, yes. So one of my questions is You've had a number of different exhibits now, but who give us an example of who you've shown.
Some of the people that we've had in the past, one of the ones that is, you know, is one of the favorites of mine, Chip Kidd, we've been lucky enough, who's, you know, a graphic designer
award-winning graphic designer.
Award-winning.
And also the author of a TED talk or two.
Correct. Mm-hmm. And just fabulous, wonderful, interesting person. We've been fortunate to have great, you know, art enthusiasts like Jerry Halloran show and exhibit his work there, as well as artists from the community. We try to support a lot of local artists and the community. That is one of the missions, of course, of the university and the university's gallery, to support local art. So we have artists like Laura Lynn White and Suzanne Fellow and Peter John Schneider's work in the gallery. Mm-hmm. Goggle Works artists who are local here as well too. Mm-hmm. Suzanne Fellow's was quite a interesting show combined with Peter John Schneider's work. It was for the elephants. Mm-hmm. For again,
they were supporting I can't remember the name of the program, but it's a save an elephant a day. Mm-hmm. You know, so so they 99 elephants a day are being slaughtered.
Absolutely, yeah, and that's
In Kenya, and she has made it her sincerest effort to save at least one elephant. Mm-hmm.
And that was a big reason we wanted to bring it to the university, just to bring awareness to, again, show the students and let these, again, students who are just at the age of 18 through, 22, a lot of our underclassmen, our traditional students, to bring awareness, to let them know. And what was wonderful is that Peter John Schneider created a fabulous sculpture that was unique to the atrium space there in the Francis Hall building. And so that was really special to have that as well, too.
Yeah, he's an amazing guy. He has a lot of his exhibits are planned as installations for the space that they inhabit. So he works like that a lot, and he's also a gardening expert. He used to own his own business called Garden Works, where he went around and did these elaborate garden installations.
Oh, very beautiful. Again, very
beautiful
big
stuff,
as well,
yeah.
too. And we have an exciting year coming up as well, too, with the programming all set for the 2015-2016 academic calendar year. We'll start off with a faculty staff exhibition, followed by Ron Orlando, who is a wildlife painter, who is also from the Pennsylvania area. We'll then have the American Society for Cell Biology, who will be bringing these posters that are all, again, microcosmic, again, really zoomed in cells, so very interesting colors and wonderful, beautiful stuff. And of course, each semester is ended with a student art show, so again, all the work that the students have done throughout the semester is then put on display for those to see. The second semester, we have Len Davis, followed by Kristen Woodward and Bertie Zoltan. And then we have Theo Anderson, who's a wonderful photographer, who will be showing some of his work, and then again the student art show at the end of the semester.
So, very good. Yes. So almost one a month, is that?
We try to do four each semester. Mm-hmm. So we try to tie as many different elements and themes that we can throughout the semester that will help, again, build upon the curriculum at the university on multiple levels.
So you're juggling all of this plus your own teaching responsibilities?
No, it's not so much juggling, it's just organizing.
It's organizing.
Exactly.
Well, if you're good, right?
Yeah. Exactly.
You gotta be good at it.
But the teaching's a lot of fun as well, too. As I said, I find myself at home in the classroom. I enjoy that space. I enjoy being around the students. One of the things that the university did in hiring me is they brought me here to start an array of new classes within the digital arts and the graphic arts side of things. So we have a lot of new curriculum being added to the university's art program or art, again, minor that is currently in place. Mm-hmm. Hopefully at some point in time we'll have a major in place. With that being said, a lot of digital and new technology. Everything's current now with, a wonderful media suite with, computers and all the latest digital software.
Well, you've done quite a bit of that yourself, too.
Yes, I have.
We'll take a look at that.
I find that it's good to stay current, even though I'm a little bit of the old and traditional ways. We have these new things that are fun to use.
I'm also with the impression you're somewhat of a polymath. That you have you do a number of different things all the.
I do. I like to use the word Renaissance man.
Okay.
I like to think of the fact that I have a lot of different diverse talents. Mm-hmm. The idea that a lot of those artists during the Renaissance had those skill sets in multiple areas. Mm-hmm. And I think you said earlier on in the program, you got to wear multiple hats nowadays. I don't believe that any one skill set is you know, definitive and so forth. So you need to have multiple hats and know multiple skills to really to do something different and create something new or have something, you know, outstanding, so to speak.
Well, a lot of artists, this is just a view that I've had, are trying to brand themselves. So what they're doing is they're looking for a specific style, a particular look, you know, something that they do which is different than anybody else, and then they brand it and say, like, this is mine, you know. And then what happens, I think, is they lock themselves into it. Art critic Dave Hickey said on Facebook, he says that, you know, style is a frock. You put it on and you wear it for a little bit, and you take it off and you put a different one on, you know.
Correct. Yeah.
And I mean, that's pretty much of the way I feel about it, and that's, I think, that the way you feel about it as well.
I really do, and that's just me personally. I think maybe part of it's just because I still have a bit of that hyperactivity disorder that I had when I was a child, and so now there's always something to do. There's always something that interests me. There's always something that sparks my, you know, imagination and grabs my attention. I think one of the biggest things is, for me, starting to shut off some of those extra things that happen in the world to allow myself to see, because I really believe that one of the most important things, you know, is our seeing, that, you know, the idea of visual within the visual arts is so important, and just being able to see something different, look at something, and being able to extract it in a way that is meaningful to me, and then maybe could be meaningful to others as well too.
Well, and then again too, you want to clear your head out of all of that other disturbing stuff. I mean, I've seen things on television, just regular, ordinary television, that are just very disturbing, you know? And then like, what happens is you just, like, you walk out into the world, and you're carrying this image in the back of your head, and, you know, it's just not right. I think that there should be a level of peacefulness and enjoyability to life, you know, not have to go out and think horrible things, you know?
I agree with that. I think there's, you know, again, too much of the chaos that we get caught up in or swept up in, and I think there's a lot of joy and beauty out there. One of the things, you know, I say to students often is take time to stop and smell the roses. And if you don't like smelling roses, just take time to stop and smell something. Just take that time. Be, as you said, at peace for a minute or two. And so, you know, whatever that means doing, take that time to do it.
Like, I have a new word that's new to me anyway. It's not a new word, but the chaotic was just introduced to me by Susan Rohn, as a matter of fact, over at the Yoakum Institute of Fine Arts, had mentioned it to me just yesterday about chaotic, which is chaos and order, and having the properties of both of them together. So there's like a very I'm looking at it almost in like particle physics theory, you know, where you can have two of the same things occupying the same space at the same time, you know. And you know, chaos and order, it seems that we've lost the ability to differentiate the two, that we either have one or the other, and there's a lot of duality inside of
I think there is, I agree, you know. And again, just that idea, you know, back to the yin and yang of life.
Yeah.
You know, the deltas and the omegas, there are ups and our downs, and it depends on where you're focusing most of your attention. If you, again, focus your attention on that chaos, that, again, plaguing, dark, you know, ugly side, then you tend to see more of that and be aware of more of that. If you tend to, again, allow those sides to be happier and joyous.
If you see chaos and order as the same thing.
Oh, yes, you know, absolutely. Yeah. The two have balance, I think, within the world. I think, you know, this is your one thing ebbs, the other flows, and they're back and forth. I think that you really can have this dichotomy, as you were saying. I think that there is order and chaos together. I think this idea of the two living, you know, within each other is
in a union of sorts.
Correct, yeah.
So maybe we should discuss your art.
We can.
Okay. I can get into these philosophical conversations. I love them. But anyway, we have a bunch of... you brought your slides with you.
I did. You said you had slides that you wanted me to bring.
Okay. Well, here. Now, let me show you the first slide here.
Do you want me to help hold these up?
Yeah, can you hold that up? Can you zero in on that, please?
Yeah, here we go. Yeah. I have some of these here. That one might be a pretty
good the same. This is a good
set. That's a chair that I did.
Yeah.
This is a sculpture here.
Uh-huh.
This one, yeah. I think it goes this way. Yeah.
Okay.
There could be a couple others. I hope the viewers... Oh, this is a really neat one, too.
That
was a turning I did. I don't know if it's that way or that way.
Uh-huh.
Usually you got to put them in the thing the correct way, but I guess they don't have that technology anymore.
Huh? No, that's... We're
dating myself now here. Huh?
Yeah, it's become archaic now.
Okay.
But we've been just joshing you, folks. We actually have some digital images here that we can show you. We're going to begin first with... what's this series called?
This is my Modern Pilgrimage series. This series is very interesting. It's one of the first series that I started when I really started to focus on developing a body of work within a certain area. The images of St. Joseph. What's interesting about the image of St. Joseph, my faith and background is within the Catholic roots, and I'm a practicing Catholic still. St. Joseph, he was buried in my front yard, so those Catholics said, no, you bury the statue, you say the prayer, and it aids in selling the house. So the house sold, you unbury St. Joseph, and you take him on with you. So leaving North Carolina and traveling to Florida to start teaching down there, I said, what do I do with St. Joseph? And so I put a little tape underneath him and smacked him up on the dashboard, and kind of thought of this idea of this, dashboard Jesus, St. Joseph, sort of traveling and guiding along with me, as well as there's, the old songs out there about that as well, too.
Mm-hmm.
So what's interesting is these images, none of them are staged, so to speak. They're while I'm driving. I'm actively involved in the process of driving, and so I'm not looking through. This is before, again, digital cameras even had the viewfinders on the back where you'd have the live feed of seeing what you're about to shoot. So I'd have to actually look through the little peephole, and you don't want to do that when driving, 70, 80 miles an hour down the highway. But with that being said, you just snap a lot of pictures, you kind of look generally to line something up, and you fire a lot hoping that you're going to get one or two, and I really do very little editing at all, and the editing really is nothing more than cropping. And so what I try to do is I try to crop out some of the things and elements that give the idea of a car being in there. So you see then St. Joseph here now. I call this one Religious Rush. This is rush hour heading to Chicago. You can see the Sears Tower over there on the left of the image. You can see the L over there on the lower left corner as well, too.
Mm-hmm.
I was on my way back from Florida at one point in time to visit the family, probably summer just based upon the light and the colors of things there. And just took this photo as we were coming in.
Gives an impression of St. Joseph, kind of like like going through the environment. It's almost it's almost like you have the ghost of St. Joseph
with me, because this idea of modern pilgrimage to me really at the time when he went on my dashboard was that we all sort of get in our cars, our vehicles, and next thing we know, we're just from A to B. There is no thought. There is no real processing. We tend to turn the radio on, zone out, and not think about even the journey. So this really came to me, this idea of pilgrimage, thinking about, again, a lot of the saints who I've learned about and studied about in my past, just thinking about even St. Joseph himself and the Holy Family, again, the pilgrimage and the flight to Egypt and so forth. This idea that when they did these pilgrimages, it was a journey that was very, again, well thought out, planned, organized. It was with a lot of other people at times. So there was a lot of, again, intermingling and things with community happening at the same time. And it built, again, in a very meaningful way as they finally got to where they were, going on that pilgrimage, that journey. So I started to, turn the radio off, started to really look, started to see things. So now I have this in my mind that there's this spot somewhere, even mile markers. I remember mile markers in my head saying I want to be aware to get the camera out because there's something. And one of those things was, every time I drove by the Olympic torch, I don't have one of them, I said, we're going to get a picture of St. Joseph. And finally, I, got that picture in Atlanta 1 year as we went by the torch out there on the highway.
Yep. So you'd sometimes have a specific
thought in mind.
Yeah.
Sometimes.
Yeah.
And a lot of times it's just, oh my God, is that what I see up there? Get the camera out and hope that as things are again passing and coming and going, they work out. Well, and then the statue changes as well, too. So there's one in here that I've included along the way that is, you know, just a different statue. It's the Christ Child. And then, you know, I've placed other saints in as well, too. Oh, maybe I didn't. There it is.
There it is.
There it is. Yeah. This is for a farm show over at Studio B recently. So for the farm show, I said I thought this was perfect. Just, again, the Christ Child with Eucharist sitting in front of the wheat field somewhere probably in the Midwestern plains as I'm driving by. And, you know, caught this farm and the silos and the granary and everything. So
pretty interesting.
Thank you.
I'm going to go back to that. Okay.
Yeah. But yeah, just trying to find these interesting compositions where it looks like he belongs in the scene. This one, you know, where he's carrying his jug and his tools and so forth, his carpentry tools. It almost makes me believe that maybe he did step out of this truck, or that he's, again, passing by or walking through, you know, on his sort of journey, wherever it might be.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. So how do we get to the next series here?
I don't know.
I don't know.
That was your job. My job was just to talk about the artwork.
I know.
Do you have to escape out of there?
I guess that's probably it.
There we go.
Okay.
There we go. So the next series, I believe, that we have begun when I was actually in Sarasota, Florida, and teaching down there. The series is what I call Reinventing the Renaissance. And it's an interesting sort of process of developing or creating a image, as you know, for developing, I guess, a fine art image. They're all on the traditional side versus, again, digital, or again, the digital photography that we just saw. The images themselves are all from the Renaissance, and they're old paintings that I've then taken and started to embellish and imbue different sort of qualities within them to really sort of, you know, take the meaning in a different way. And I see Ron's just about getting the slides up here.
Almost
and
out.
See that the first one's, of course, twisted, so maybe we'll
this is sideways.
Yeah, we'll just maybe show that for a brief second. But the way they start out is our small collages. And so the small collages then move on to line drawings. So we have this line drawing here. And this drawing itself is a Raphael painting. And the Raphael painting is a lady with a young veil. And so the original Raphael is still the veil, her arms that are folded with her hands in front. And so then I started to look for the right things to fit in. So she changed into this horse. And then eventually I found these wings. So she became the Pegasus with a veil.
So did you have any type of meaning that you were coming to?
No, it was nothing more than sarcasm, satire, looking at images that were part of history and readily available history that we see and are used often in media, specifically, again, current media nowadays. And so with that being said, just taking the twist out where those, I think, who are maybe savvy enough might be able to pick the bits and the pieces apart and say, wait a second, I've seen this before. This is so-and-so. This is, and then, okay, so these things have twisted. So with that being said, I like that idea of satire and that idea that those who are, again, maybe in the know of art
It's also indicative of your knowledge of art and that of other people's knowledge of art and the importance that we bestow on certain types of art, like Raphael has almost like a saintly art, you know, reputation. That this guy's Raphael's one of the Renaissance masters.
Correct. So, and I think the other thing for me too at the time is learning about you know, people such like Maggie Taylor, who are doing a lot of these in collaging. And so these start out as small collages. I know it's upside down. Maybe we can again flip to it. So they start as small collages like this that, you know, I just start to find these bits and pieces and start to layer the image itself. And then it turns into a simple line drawing. And then we can go to that next slide if you want. And that next slide is where they become maybe even just a little bit more detailed of a drawing, where value and volume now starts to take, you know, shape and so forth. And so this is Petrus Christie's young woman, and this becomes now, again, the woman with the beak. And so she's got a little beak for a nose instead of
nose. Yeah, it looks almost like a nautilus.
Yeah, it's a bird beak. I'm not sure specifically what kind of bird beak, but it's definitely a bird beak. And then all these little flowers and gems and jewels in this big old wonderful greenery hair dress that I sort of put up. And then this circuit board behind her just sort of contrasting again the idea of Renaissance and technology, I think, was one of the things that really interests me. I believe that we are in a new Renaissance almost ourselves, Ron, that the emergence of technology right now is so great. It's our job as artists now to really start to figure out how to handle it, grapple with it, and create new things with it. And, and the designs now that are coming out, I think, would have really amazed even those back in the Renaissance, because the emergence of technology and thinking then was quite impressive for those people and artists.
Well, we are miles and miles beyond that now. But speaking relatively as a comparison, what was happening then was considered the most advanced stages of art and science and culture, you know, for its time.
Absolutely.
You know, so it actually stands as almost a symbolic representative of what's going on today, because you know we have so much stuff now. They're talking about artificial humans and you know active intelligence with machinery and stuff. I mean that's I mean there's some things that are just really too much to comprehend.
But I find them fun. These are really enjoyable. It to me again allows me to tie back into all of the traditional art sets that I learned when I was at the Rhode Island School of Design, as well as we were the first classes to start the digital. You know, we were learning Photoshop 2.0, Ron. I mean, we're on version 16 now, so it was something back then to learn a program that was just in its infancy to be able to hit a render button and walk away from your work for 30 minutes.
For 30 minutes
and
or
not
more.
Have to worry about it, because the computer's just trying to put a simple gradation behind behind an image.
Or even to upload an image to the web right now. I mean, sometimes it takes a terribly long time, depending on how much you know memory you have inside of that film. Now, you did say to me earlier that all of these drawings are hand drawn.
Yes,
they're not digitally drawn.
Correct.
So you did everything you know eye to hand.
Correct. All graphite.
On graphite. Mm-hmm. Yep. Okay. And now, you did that one.
And this was Jan van Eyck's Man with the Red Thread Turban, which a lot of people knew, and then turned into the elephant with a nest of eggs on his head.
See, it's a joke, actually.
Yeah. It becomes, like I said, just a little bit of satire, a little bit of humor.
Well, very thought-involving. It seems that you have to look at these for a while to really...
To find what sort of wants to fit, what wants to belong, how the image itself starts to take on a life of itself. You are really, as you said, you're looking at many different things and saying what can fit, what can look good, what will be visually interesting and appeal again to me. And if it appeals to me, I know that there's going to be at least one other person hopefully out there that it might appeal to.
Well, it's almost like a conundrum in a way. It's like you can't, it's like you're looking at it and you're trying to figure it out. I mean, I'm staring at this thing and I'm saying, okay, well, I recognize this, but I don't see that. And what's the significance of this? Is that fruit, or is that an egg, or what is that? You know, you think to yourself, oh, well, I think I see. Do I see a gun in there? No. You know, I mean, it's just like all of these questions. It's you know what? I compare it to remember Highlights for Children when they had the tree and the objects hidden, the hidden objects inside of the tree and stuff. And you say, find the hidden objects, you know? And you look and look and look and look and you can't find it. And then all of a sudden you see where the squirrel is and you go like, oh, that's where it is. And then every time you look, you see it every single time, you know? So it's just interesting stuff. Now here's another one.
Old portrait of Francesco d'Estate, who now has become the monkey with the pelican head. As a staff, so, and then hands memling. And there is the original one that we saw, the little maquette for that starts to become the pencil drawing. And then eventually, you know, they start to build into volumes. So again, right now they are rather flat, as you were mentioning. Things become a little bit more obscured and so forth within the line drawings. But it's just sort of the process that I use, going from again the small maquette that we just saw there to then the line drawing, to then that sort of volume drawing, which is then the next one. down where that things way. Start to have a little bit more value and room to grow.
Hmm. Okay, very good. Very cool. So I'm going to go to the next file here when I find it.
So we've got escape again, I believe.
Yeah, I'm not used to this. Mm-hmm. Okay.
And I think, what was the next series that we were looking at was, what was the third one? That was Folded Tomes?
Yeah.
Oh, this is the work that you saw and were interested in.
Yeah, yeah.
This was the stuff that was at Studio B most recently. I received an honorable mention award for some of this work that was there. These were interesting. These started as something I had seen somewhere on the internet. And so with that being said, I'm not the biggest reader, but this sort of, you know, helped me. That one's upside down. I don't know how some of these got upside down.
I know, I've been having the same problem with this. I mean, I put them on a disc, and they're right side up on the disc, but they went and bring them over here.
We saw these all. But this was just an example that I've done some really small ones as well, too. We're nothing more than, I'm looking at balance and symmetry. For the most part, and these are all books that I've then taken and folded the pages so that they open up into a sculpture and become a relief. And so it was a way that I found that I could exhibit sculptural work into areas where they had to be wall hanging type exhibits. So some of these are rather small, like this one here, size of the apple. Mm-hmm. So a very small book that got folded. And then some of them are rather big and are full size books. But folded none the same. What I usually do when approaching a project is I look at the book itself. So I'm looking at this book, and this was, I took a graphic novel, and I thought it would be interesting because the pages, when folded, would start to give this really, almost as you were talking earlier, chaotic sort of sense to the structure, because it's not the standard rigid lines of type that are, again, all, again, set within a mathematics. So each page, the graphics, again, are changing, so therefore this shape becomes really, again, chaotic and energetic. So I really thought of this sort of massive uplifting structure with these spikes pointing out, because, again, there was so much of this sort of black and white happening within the space. So I look at then the number of the pages of the book. My mother was a math professor back home in Milwaukee. And so using just simple math, just a simple logarithm, counting the number of pages, plug in these equations of these are the number of folds that I can do and a different number of patterns or rhythm or sequencing of folds so that it ends up folding out and being balanced and having symmetry so that it doesn't end abruptly, so it sort of ends the way it started. So
you think that science is like math is important? In the production of your art?
I think that, again, as we had said earlier, interdisciplinary. I believe that a lot of different skill sets are involved in any one area. And so for me, yes, mathematics plays a heavy role into a lot of the things, which maybe is more why sometimes we're called or classified as designers and so forth. So I really, focus on math at times, science at times, and looking at what they, can allow me to do. The example I use a lot of times to students when we're talking and doing color theory, and they ask me, well, why are we using colored paper and doing cut collages versus painting and pigment? And it's the idea that painting becomes so much about chemistry and remembering how to make that same exact color the second time. If we're not really involved in the chemical process or the chemistry process of the mixing, we're just then again making colors and hoping that, they're going to be as closely related to the color that we're expecting.
You have to have a pretty good idea of what you're trying to do, too. If you're working with color, you have to know, the color wheel, color opposites, color chromatics. It's just a lot to know with that. Which is, sometimes it does help to go to school, and learn about this type of stuff.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. So it is. It's about chemistry. It's about combinations, it's about planning, it's about, but this here, do you have this idea in your head that it is going to look like that when you're...
I get a basic idea after, say, the first few dozen folds. If it's not looking what I'm sort of thinking it's going to look like, then I start to change it up or do something different. And what's interesting is, again, you start to look at and study origami a little bit and look at things, you know, in a sort of different manner. And how do these, you know, just subtle changes to a cut, because not everything is always folded. Sometimes, you know, a page is cut so that, again, it can counterfold or fold in the opposite direction or a different way.
I think formally it makes a really good structural device. I mean, you could look at it as it is without, you know, with all of the underpinnings. I mean, you have the philosophy and the procedure and the process and all of that of how it is. But when you just look at it, it has such a nice, easy to relate to form.
Thank you.
You know, and you know, I mean, it's once you actually see, it seems like that's what introduces you to it, is the its presence, and then beyond that, you can go and delve into all of its.
So these last three that we just saw were all the size of that apple or smaller. The next ones that we're going to see, and so these are in and of itself just a challenge, just because of the fact that the folding itself in this small space, and trying to keep it so that line at the top and the ridge, you know, rides exactly the same and is balanced, it can be a challenge. But these, the next few are all full-size books. These really stand out from the wall. They really, as you said, they grab an attention in sort of a different way.
Well, you can just see them being made out of clay or something, and it would be a different, you know, it would have a different experience.
Absolutely.
You know, or marble or or something.
But I enjoy then building the wooden frames as well, too, you know, finding a hardwood frame, but just thinking about the connection, again, of the book to the tree, and this idea that the two, again, were related, intertied, or interconnected. The idea, you know, of recycling and renewing, reusing, rebirthing, repurposing, I think is an important thing that we need to really consciously consider this, you know, to me, is an important, you know, topic, and this idea of how do we keep things out of the landfill, how do we reuse them, renew them, how do we bring meaning to them again. You know, books and paper tend to be a very heavily, you know, thrown away thing, but at the same time it can be recycled.
Right, it also reintroduces you to a history of objects, items, and ways of living that we had before that we no longer used. And sometimes you have a book. I mean, how many people are using a Kindle now instead of reading an actual book?
Absolutely.
You know? Absolutely. So it's like they look at that and they go like, oh, I can't believe it. That was actually what you read.
Yeah.
You know? It's like, yeah, things change pretty severely.
They do.
Now, this one here, it almost looks like a lamp.
It does.
Yeah.
It's interesting. The frame's not really showing up on the screen here too well, probably not showing up real well at home either for you all. But yeah, it really is, you know, the lighting and everything really made it bright and so forth. So some of these, when they're sitting in the gallery and being hung and the lights on them the right way, you know, because each book is different. Some of the books are, you know, a paper that is more closely related to newsprint, and some of the books, you know, printed that are those hardbound back papers, you know, the paper is a little bit nicer, a little bit starchier, a little bit whiter.
Now, you said at one point you were using a graphic novel for it. Do you have any particular kind of book that you're using?
It's really, like I said, it's looking at the book and is there a number of pages that I can divide into some mathematical sequence that I can then create some rhythm and some patterning with that could be interesting.
Yeah, so it's pretty much formal, not so much, you know.
Correct.
Yeah. Now, this one here, it looks like you cut into it.
Yep, so pages, you know, as I said, the pages I manipulate in any way I can to get, you know, the shape that I desire, and even to the point of taking and, you know, curling the pages themselves so that the pages, you know, again, have a very different, unique look to them.
Now, you have titles for these?
There's a lot of, you know, I don't know if that was something. Yes, I have a title for it, Ron. I said I would do this if this question was there. This is the Exodus of Icarus from the Garden of Eden after his original sin.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah. No, I don't know that artwork needs.
It's easy for you to say.
Yeah, I don't know that artwork really needs you know, elaborate titles a lot of time. I think that some artwork really does. For me, though, I don't know if it's a cop out. You can tell me. You're the art critic. I've done a lot of them. Just all of these are called tomes. So this I have somewhere around now 30 of these that I've done. So this could be folded tome number 1 or folded tome number 18 or folded tome number 30.
I personally like that more, because when you add a title to it and the title has an actual meaning behind it, it kind of attaches the artwork to the meaning.
Yeah.
And really, I'm with the impression that the meaning of the artwork is not owned either by the artwork or by the artist. That you that when you put something out there, the meaning of the artwork is actually owned by the person that views it.
Correct.
The person that buys it. Yeah.
I believe that 100%. And that's one of those things. You never go into someone's home and it's not like a museum. There's never a little tag sitting up next to the artwork saying, this is the title of this piece. So
yep.
I agree, it is owned by the person who inevitably hangs it.
So titles then are a little bit too imposing.
Yes. Yeah. I said, so the modern pilgrimages, they all have original titles like the religious rush that I mentioned.
Mm-hmm.
These, yeah, folded tomes, there's nothing more.
It's different in that manner because there is meaning behind that. You know, this here, well, we're into abstraction right now. So it's a different mentality, and it becomes much more involved with the form and the basic appearance of it and its presence in the real world, as opposed to some imaginary thought process that you may have come across. Now, I mean, what you did, you took photographs of something real in the real world, but it had significance beyond what it was, and that says something. Now, let's see. What?
I don't know if there's one more or not. Are you at the end?
Look at that one. Wow, that's nice.
So like I said, I'm really looking to find, again, where can I establish that balance, and are there enough pages to, you know, keep that symmetry flowing throughout the book?
Mm-hmm. These must be very labor-intensive. I mean,
They can be labor-intensive. As I said, the smaller ones were extremely labor-intensive because of the size of the pages. Mm-hmm. And just trying to, again, keep my fingers, you know, in those same spots. The bigger ones, again, you have your little tricks and things here and there for, you know, finding marks and hitting marks and keeping things to fold, you know, your bone folder that every artist, you know, has somewhere out there who's a fine artist and doesn't need paperwork.
Mm-hmm.
Your bone folder comes in really handy and saves your finger and your fingernail from rubbing and creasing things back and forth.
Right, your fingers could become quite raw.
I think some of this, too, though, gives a little testimony to my OCD and just, you know, how structured can it be and how sort of retentive can I be to keeping it, you know, sort of meticulous.
Well, well, in that case, the OCD is a benefit.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Okay, back to that.
So again, there is that just size of those small ones, so it is really challenging when they are that small.
Folks, stand on your head to look at this one. Okay. All right, and I'm going to see if I can find the...
Yeah. So I think we're looking at the Rorschach.
We're going to do the Rorschach next.
This is my favorite sort of series that I'm still working on. And all these I sort of continue to work on throughout my processing and life. But these currently are of great favorite to me. This series came about when I was on a beach one day, drawing probably at the beach, doodling after a day of work. And I looked up at a cloud and I, you know, looked up that cloud and I said to myself, boy, if I took that cloud and mirrored it in Photoshop and cropped it right, it would look like one of Rorschach's ink blots and ink tests. Mm-hmm. And so I did it, and then I went and looked up his ink tests, and he had, I believe it was 8 original black and white, and then he had, I think, 4 color ones, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And so when I looked at it, it was pretty close to what I remembered it as a child when I had seen those and been, you know, given that test and so forth. So for me, these are really great because I love the idea of psychology. I love the idea that everyone who looks at them sees something different, doesn't necessarily see the same thing,
mm-hmm.
Or identify with the same thing. I love the fact that all we're doing here is this simple mirroring of the image and playing on this idea of positive and negative space and value. So really just looking at simple elements to create sort of complex imagery. And it's really not that the imagery becomes that complex, it's the visuals that the person themselves sort of experiences. And the majority of these are all large prints. So one like this that we're looking at is maybe about 48 by 24 in size, because I really want the viewer to be immersed in this field, to really start to see things and find things that connect to them and to their psyche. You know, I'd be really interested in having a little pedestal with a notebook next to some of these in shows, and just, you know, inquiring upon people. You know, what do you see? What are you mm-hmm. seeing? And what are you getting?
Well, it's always the same thing. Like, say you have you're a kid and you're laying on the grass in the field and you're looking up at the clouds and you say, "Oh, I see a choo-choo train." Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, these are much more complex.
Yeah.
Much more complex.
Thank you.
I would love to see these, the real versions of these in a gallery somewhere. I think they would be.
Thank you.
Really.
Thank you.
And back to that first one. Yeah.
What I also find, you know, interesting, Ron, and that's the other thing that's really unique about these, is I double hang these. So one of the things that you have to remember with the Rorschach test is that there was no preconceived direction. So it's kind of almost kind of, we're looking at these in a manner where we're forcing the viewer to experience them in the way that we want them to. Instead of the fact that, you know, this could be upside down right now, and what we will see and what we'll perceive is absolutely 100% different than what we're seeing the other direction currently. So that's the neat part about these, is I you know, wire them to be hung in either direction so that the artwork itself can change, that it doesn't have to be, again, static even within the home. That the person can, you know, do it 180 degrees and flip it around and have a whole new experience.
Yeah, I find it really interesting. I mean, this almost has, I mean, some of these, I almost see facial characteristics in them, you know. Like,
absolutely.
Like, I don't know.
I see some animals and beasts in this one, especially the middle character who's there. The screen and probably what people are seeing at home on the TV is just a little bit washed out from our computer screen here, which is a little bit closer probably to the actual image. But yeah, there's some sort of haunting things in there a little bit for me.
Really? Yeah. Same here. But this one here, it almost looks like an X-ray.
Mm-hmm.
It's so dynamic. There's so much with the sun and behind the one set of clouds, you know, being mirrored. It really has a very dramatic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And just the idea of playing with, you know, the positive and the negative space. It doesn't always have to be the clouds forming the you know, structure and so forth.
Hey, that's a guy with his hands on his hips.
Yeah, I see this yoga pose,
this
almost character creature that's, you know, sitting and meditating there. A lot of people say they see some sort of demonic sort of characters and creatures, but yeah.
Oh, you know who it is. You know who it is. It's like the Fantastic Four Galactus dude.
There you go.
It's
there
Galactus. Yeah. So we're back to this one then. So we have about 3 minutes left.
Okay.
So just to let you know, was there anything that you wanted to talk about that we have missed?
No, I think we've talked about a lot of stuff. I can't believe that the time's already flown by, Ron. This has been a really great pleasure and delight to be on your show.
I could talk a lot more, really.
You know, definitely like to thank, you know, all of the support that I've had throughout my life. Knowing that Mom and Dad will watch this, definitely like to thank Mom and Dad for all the support. Thank them for sending me to the Rhode Island School of Design to be a small fish in a big pond. I'd like to thank again all the people who are in this wonderful community of Berks County, who I'm getting to, you know and now starting to call home myself as well too. You know, I've been privileged to meet you and others as well, and starting to learn.
You have a lot of admiration from the community. People are really really coming to you and seeing you as a positive influence. I mean, we always enjoy when people come into the area, you know, to bolster it, because this area does need some work.
Yeah. Well, thank you. So. Thank you. I appreciate that. And again, I said it earlier, I'd like to continue my gratitude and thanks to the Millers. The space is a wonderful space at Alvernia University. It is really beautiful. I encourage everyone who's out there to come on down to Alvernia University and check out a gallery show and be part of a reception. All the information's on our website.
Yep.
Please, you know, go to the Arts and Cultures page and you'll see the lineup for next semester.
Yeah, that's excellent. Okay, shall we, was there some There was more stuff here, wasn't there?
There was some sculpture. If you want to show the, one of the things, if you go to the other that's in there, I think we got, goodbye. We got to say goodbye.
Right? Oh, it's goodbye time. All right. Well, anyhow, this has been the show for tonight. And as usual, I could talk a lot more. Peter Rampson.
Until next time, invite me
back.
Yeah,
you'll come back. Yeah.
Sounds good.
Yeah, I appreciate that.
We can't go online like the Colbert Report or anything like that and watch everything else online after this?
You can watch this online. Okay. Yeah,
I didn't know if we could keep doing the interview and then they'd just be able to tune in later and see the rest of it. No?
No, I don't think so. I don't know. They sometimes record it just for our own.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. But, this is great. And thank you so very much for joining us tonight on New Arts Alive. My guest, Peter Rampson. I'm Ron Schira. Thank you very much for joining us. Have a wonderful evening.
Thank you.
New Arts Alive is produced through Berks Community Television and can be seen live on the second Tuesday of each month at 5 p.m. Consult your local community cable service for live and repeat programming. For more information about the New Arts program and its consultation residencies of artists from the literary, visual, and performing arts, call 683-6440 or write New Arts Program, P.O. Box 82, Kutztown, PA 19530. Or visit the office and exhibition space at 173 West Main Street, Kutztown, PA.
Hours are Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, 1 to 5, Saturday, 10 to 2, or by appointment.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.